Welcome back, geology fans. It's a big day here on Earth Explorations, as today we will take all we have learned so far and apply boots-on-the-ground geologic field investigation to the Colorado School of Mines campus. We traditionally begin in our lab classrooms and head down Maple Street to the front of our geology museum, where we meet our first rock for the day, and the last rock that is not in place for us to map in. Here's a white, recrystallized rock. It's sugary in its texture, so we should predict a non-foliated metamorphic rock. Our two main choices, then, are marble, made of calcite, or quartzite, made of quartz. So we try some hydrochloric acid and watch the effervescent reaction to know that this is marble, not quartzite, and thus it used to be a limestone. This is the Yule Marble, the state rock of Colorado, a major building stone of the U.S. Capitol in D.C., but it speaks of a time when the center of our state was under an ocean, depositing a thick marine limestone, nice and pure. So as we head out into our actual campus geology, we are already met with the concept that this state has gone through tremendous changes through geologic history. To get to our first in-place geology, we will walk down Maple Street, but your funny instructor wants you to get a bearing on Maple Street first. We use our compass to sight down the street and read off an azimuth direction of 320 degrees, basically northwest. We also note our elevation of 5,560 feet above above 1920 sea level. Don't worry, this isn't pointless. We will look at these numbers again at the end of this lab. We walk behind the Geology Museum and past a memorial to 10 coal miners lost in an accident at this site back in 1889, 15 years after the territory of Colorado established the School of Mines. But I want to discuss this in proper order of the formations that we will see today, and so we want to continue up the hill, pausing only to note this strangely brecciated rock and sharp contact, which implies a fault penetrating this rock face, making a fault breccia and a sharp contact and tiny little coal exposure there. So let's hike up this trail to get a look at that better, and then our first in-place rock. But we already know we don't run close up to the rock face to begin with. We attempt to look at the big picture first. These days, this can be from Google Earth, which is a great first view and helps us notice the elephant in the room at our location. We're on the flanks of a significant mountain range, the Rocky Mountains. I say the elephant in the room, but I really like the analogy of the late great Wyoming geologist Dave Love, recipient of the first Legendary Geologist Award from GSA in 1999, having an amazing career, including mapping all of Wyoming as lead author twice, and was hiking into the Absaroka mountain range east of Yellowstone in his 80s. He finally died at the age of 89. So Dr. Love's analogy for the Rocky Mountains was that it was as if a bunch of pigs were sleeping under Paleozoic and Mesozoic aged blankets, inspiring this image from the wonderful artist Ray Troll. But for reasons Dr. Love left vague, as we have only recently been able to work out this puzzling mountain range, hint shallow subductor, these pigs woke up, got restless, giving a slight uplift to the overlying blankets, and then stood up, thrusting through the blankets, ramping them up at the edges, taking some of those Paleozoic and Mesozoic aged beds up to only survive the uplift and erosion and isolated pockets up there in the mountains. Some seriously tilted beds on the flanks here. Our location provides us a good vantage where we can see the pig that stood up to our west. There in the steep young river valley of Clear Creek, we see folded and banded rock in the canyon wall. We suspect metamorphic gneiss from here, but we will take a trip to Red Rocks to get a better look at that. In the midground and off in the distance, we see the flat irons of Boulder and the tilted rock between there and here. And right behind us, our first in-place geology appears as layers of rock that are also tilted. The flat irons out in Boulder dip to the east, and towards the mid-ground they seem to come more vertically, and these layers behind us, they're dipping to the west. Interesting. Now, the beds make us think sedimentary rock and must be part of those Paleozoic or Mesozoic age blankets Dr. Love mentioned that the local pig making our front range in this area thrust up. It was a pretty big pig here, as we find out, and did some serious uplift in our location. As we continue to scan our location, we see the Table Mountains to our east and note that the layering that appears there are basically horizontal, not tilted. So a bit of reasoning leads us to say that the rock layers that have been tilted from their originally horizontal positions were here before the pig stood up and tilted them, before the formation of the Rocky Mountains in our area. And those horizontal layers, seemingly undisturbed from when they were deposited, were formed after the Rocky Mountain uplift was done. Okay, so how much did the front range get uplifted compared to the basin block of crust that we are currently standing on? You can walk over to the front range crustal block over to Clear Creek Canyon and touch the crystalline basement rock of the Idaho Springs Gneiss. Just walk there from our campus. Or you can walk from our campus to the top of the Table Mountains and begin drilling and find some Idaho Springs Gneiss finally at about 11,000 feet over 2 miles down below. There is an impressive reverse fault, the Golden Fault, separating the front range block from the basin block that we are standing upon, with over 2 miles of displacement on it. The pig in our neighborhood really stood up. And this all speaks of massive compressional forces, compression this area has been subjected to due to the mountain uplift. It might also be useful to do some drone imaging and mapping if you have permission for the area. From this 3D model produced from drone mapping data of our field area, we see some odd patterns of differential erosion, these big ribs sticking out. We will find that this has been heavily influenced by mining on our campus. It seems that the rocks here strike the surface in a fairly north-south trending fashion, and basically parallel to the Front Range Mountains. Now that we have the big picture, the context for everything that we will see, we can turn our attention to the exposed rock outcrop behind us and start from far to close. As far back as we can get, there are apparent layers which change in bedding thickness and color from one side to the other. The layers have their heads eroded off, breaking lateral continuity, and seem to be capped with a poorly sorted mix of mostly subangular, sub-rounded clasts of mainly metamorphic rock fragments. The top layer cuts the lower layers and is basically horizontal, so we presume it will be significantly younger than the tilted layers below, at least the difference in age of the time it takes to uplift a mountain range. All the rock here appears to be sedimentary layers, but are so seriously tilted we must ask that question of any locally tilted rock. Which way is up? Which way was up? Which way was originally up so we can apply the law of superposition to put these layers in proper chronological order? As I come in a bit closer, I notice what appears to be crossbeds in one of the layers, which comes to a near parallel low angle to meet the right side of the bed, the west side, and sharper angles on the left or east side of the bed. With what we know about crossbeds as up indicators, this indicates that up was and should go to the left, to the east. These rocks aren't just tilted, they're overturned. We had a big pig stand up in our area, not just tilt the blankets up, but all the way over from vertical. To tell the story in order, we will begin on the far right, west side of this outcrop and of our campus. And to continue the story, we will progress eastward through the layers. Again, that weird horizontal layer on top must come much later. So put that as a later event in your head. Now, I think it's time to get up even closer and start on the right. just listen to our rock hammer on this stuff and watch it fall apart. Soft material, easily broken apart, that crumbles to fine powder in my hand. With a wetted test in the hand or bite test, we could find it's predominantly clay. And exposed fresh surfaces reveal facility, the slight lining up of the plate-shaped clays as they fall in water. Some chemical analysis of the clays would indicate smectite clay, including bentonite, which is indicative of marine environments. And further investigation of this formation produces marine fossils of nautiloids, ammonites, oh man, the ammonites, and clams, marine organisms all. This is definitely a marine shale, an ocean-deposited shale. There are even pterodons found. They must have been flying off from Utah shores and for guessable reasons ended up dead at the bottom of this shale-making sea. These have also been found to give the Denver Museum of Nature and Science diorama that we see of this time in Denver. We are not the first to find this shale, and so it has already been named. We call it the Pier Shale. Now, almost all formations are named after the place they were first or best described. The pier of Pier Shale is Pier, South Dakota. Wow, this shale formation is apparently quite large. So at times, the shale-making sea covered a large portion of the center of our continent. The fossils are also index fossils, telling us this sea covered this location in the Cretaceous period of the Mesozoic era. These are some of those Mesozoic blankets Dave Love was talking about. This also explains why the west side of our campus is a valley, as shales are generally weaker, more jointed, and more easily fail and faults, all of which aid in more easily pop-pop-pop eroded rock that is frequently a valley former. We will see more valleys underlain by shales in our treks, so keep that in mind. As we move up through the shale, we see light-colored bands that with a bite test come out as volcanic ash. Volcanic ash altered in seawater is a major source of the bentonite clay in the Pier Shale, and bentonite is a swelling soil problem. That clay contracts when dry and expands when wetted. Don't put building foundations directly into the Pier Shale. The ash also means we have a datable material in the clastic shale. The top of the Pier Shale produces ages of about 72 to 70 million years ago here on campus. Besides ash, we occasionally get coarser layers, more resistant to erosion as the clay gives way to silt and even sand layers. But oceans and seas do not smoothly rise and fall. They do so with a chaotic saw blade trending pattern up and down. This bed of sandstone sticking out of the top of the Pier Shale at another location shows mud cracks. The sea that formed the Pier Shale is starting to shallow and even occasionally fall, exposing dry land, only to inundate the land again with more shale, and then finally slipping away to allow sandstone to build up on top of the shale. This is a classic gradational, not sharp, contact between two different rock formations. Shale goes to shale with a little sand, which becomes sand with a little shale, and then just sandstone in what is called the Fox Hills Sandstone. Ash layers in this transition indicate it took place about 69 million years ago, an age that holds through the Fox Hills Sandstone visible to our east, to the left of this outcrop. This sand can be found across a large area and does not look associated with rivers, but more likely it is a beach sand. The cross-bedded section we see here has fine uniform sand and is thick enough to suggest beach dune formation here. And at other locations, mangrove tree fossils can be found. Yeah, these are beach deposits from a 69-million-year-old mangrove swamp. We have evidence of our campus having been beachfront property. A transition from sea to beach speaks of a regression of sea level. This could really be caused by a fall in sea level, or less likely but common enough, an uplift of the land. Well, in this case, it seems to be a bit of both. The sea, the Pier Shale tells us was here in the middle of our continent, was falling. But the pig was just waking up, and it was getting a little restless and pushing the land up slightly. Not too much, but slightly uplifting it. Our pig did not yet fully stand up, but was taking in a deep breath. How about that? With this regression having a twofold cause, a sea level fall and a slight uplift of land, we might expect the next formation to encounter after this beach sand to be a full-on terrestrial land-based deposit. But that will have to wait. Further investigation of the Fox Hills sandstone shows this place where yucca plants grow, and there is broken, brecciated Fox Hills at this location. This speaks of another fault. Remember, we saw evidence of a fault on the way up, right? In the lower slope. Or maybe this is the same fault. Ripping across our campus revealed again in this outcrop. And we take a line from this brecciated Fox Hills to the brecciated rock face below us, and even noting a brecciated toe of a further east rock rib, we start to note this north-south trending fault line which may go under our stadium. We may want to be on the lookout to the south to see if we can find any evidence of this fault again as we continue our trip today. We pause to consider a worldwide context for all these beds. The Pier Shale is 72 to 70 million years old on its top exposed beds on campus, and the Fox Hills sandstone is 69 million years old. And the Cretaceous and Mesozoic, and a great many species, end at 65.5 million years ago. We are closing in on the end of the age of dinosaurs here, and the end of the Cretaceous period, named from the German Kreta, meaning concrete. It is the time of worldwide high sea level stands, when we have no evidence of any polar ice caps, only weak evidence for small glaciers, if any, in the Appalachian Mountains of the eastern U.S. The ice was melted, the seas were warm and thermally expanded, and the seafloor spreading was just on steroids, pushing the seafloor up, so that the seas were so high that the center of our continent of North America was submerged in an intercontinental seaway. The Western Interior Seaway. Here on campus, we have witnessed the retreat of this intercontinental seaway and the initial stirrings of the Rocky Mountain uplift. Pterodons flying over ammonite-filled Cretaceous seas, giving way to mangrove swamps with the potential of dinosaurs nearby as we emerge from the water. I'll end this episode with this image of Cretaceous seas, also by artist Ray Troll. If you like fossils and paleontology, I can highly recommend the podcast Paleo Nerds that Ray is involved with. And check out his fishy artwork online. He has a wonderful collection. You can buy a lot of it on t-shirts. So when we come back next time, it's time to put all that we just noted in our field notebook, of course. Put that onto our map. Figure out that top horizontal layer, too, and then logically move on eastward and stratigraphically upward to see what's up with those rock ribs over here. Oh man, the fossils we're gonna see next time here on Earth Explorations.